The 300 horsepower V6 from Rotax has been highly anticipated by the general aviation community for years, being regularly teased by Rotax. After a lengthy test program, numerous test flights, and millions spent on development, Rotax was on the verge of receiving certification for the engine in 2006 when they suddenly did a complete 180 and announced they would not be moving forward with production. What exactly happened? Why did Rotax cancel the engine, which had the potential to disrupt the 4 and 6 seat airplane engine market? In this video, we'll examine the design of the Rotax V6 engine to determine if it had any potential for issues, as well as explore the other factors that led to the engine's cancellation. Beyond light aircraft engines, Rotax also produces engines for snowmobiles, ATVs, karts, and racing applications, among others. While often regarded as one of the more modern aero engine manufacturers, Rotax was founded in 1920 in Dresden, Germany, making the company 105 years old as of 2025. Over the decades, Rotax has undergone significant changes. Some of the more notable was its relocation to Austria in 1943 to avoid the Allied bombing raids of German cities. Then, in 1970, it was acquired by the Canadian aerospace and transportation manufacturer Bombardier. But in 2003, Bombardier divested its recreational products division, leading to the creation of BRP, Bombardier Recreational Products. This was part of a larger restructuring effort to allow Bombardier to focus on its aerospace and transportation divisions. Rotax became part of BRP. This history is important because these events played a key role in the decision to cancel the highly anticipated 300 horsepower V6. But let's take a closer look at the engine itself. Known as the Rotax 936 or V300T, it is a 3.1-liter liquid-cooled, turbocharged, gear-reduced V6 engine producing 300 horsepower at 6,000 rpm. Other than the V-cylinder layout, most of its design is familiar territory for Rotax. However, one unusual property stands out here: its 120-degree cylinder bank angle. Most V6 engines typically have a 60-degree or 90-degree bank angle, so why did Rotax choose 120 degrees? Well, for one, in terms of firing interval, 120 degrees is the ideal bank angle for a V6. Since an even firing interval on a 6-cylinder engine is 120 degrees, and the crankpin offset angle is 120 degrees, a 120 degrees V angle allows for a perfectly even firing sequence, with a cylinder firing every 120 degrees of crankshaft rotation. This is the same firing interval as an inline 6 or a horizontally opposed 6. An even firing interval is important for all engines, but especially for aircraft engines. It not only ensures smoother operation, but also reduces stress on key components like the crankshaft, camshafts, the rest of the valve train, and of course the propeller. A 90 degrees or 60 degrees V6 cannot achieve an even 120 degrees firing interval without using a split crankpin. Unlike a 120 degree V6, an hot fire 90 degree V6, a V8 or V12 where crankpins are shared by opposing connecting rods, a split crankpin offsets the big ends of the rods. In a 60 degree V6, for example, this offset or splay angle is 60 degrees, which then enables it to have an even firing interval. But this means increased manufacturing complexity, which drives up production costs. It also requires flying arms between the crankpins, adding weight, weakening the crankshaft, and making both the crankshaft and the engine longer. So then why isn't the 120 degree V6 more common, especially in the automotive world? Aside from a few supercars, the 120 degree V6 is rarely used. This is because while it provides a smooth firing interval, it is the least practical option in terms of compactness. It's only marginally narrower than a boxer engine, but nearly twice as tall. In contrast, the more compact 60 degree V6 is the go-to option for most cars, and with good reason. In aviation, however, weight and simplicity are far more important than compactness. Most light aircraft are powered by horizontally opposed engines. The 120 degree V6 makes a good retrofit option despite being a different layout, as it can fit into engine bays designed for horizontally opposed engines. On the other hand, a 60 degree V6 would struggle to fit in existing engine bays due to its height. Of course, an aircraft can be designed to accommodate just about any engine layout, but Rotax was targeting existing aircraft to retrofit, and that means the engine needs to fit into existing engine bays, and the less modification needed, the better. In this context, the 120 degree V6 is the best 6-cylinder V angle option for light aircraft, not just because of its firing interval, but with all factors considered. What about balance though? Isn't the balance of a V6 worse than the perfect balance of a horizontally opposed 6? A V6 can be seen as two inline 3-cylinder engines sharing a crankshaft. Each inline 3 has perfect secondary balance but poor primary balance. With 120 degree separated crank pins, the total up and down motion of the pistons evens out, but the opposing movement of the outer pistons create a rocking couple. When two of these inline 3s are arranged in a V configuration, like a 60 degree or 120 degree layout, the total magnitude of the imbalance force amplifies as the pistons' momentum adds together. It doesn't quite double, but the imbalance becomes larger than on a single inline 3. This imbalance can be removed by the use of balance shafts or reduced by the use of unbalanced flywheels. Balance shafts are usually the chosen method as it is more effective. However, balance shafts add complexity, which increases engine cost and maintenance and increases friction, and are thus rarely used in aircraft engines. The Rotax V6 likely does have a balance shaft, with at least one source suggesting this is the case. The other way to improve the balance of a V6 that I mentioned is by using unbalanced flywheels. With this approach, I'd expect the vibration of the running V6 to be similar to that of a large Boxer 4, like the Lycoming 0360. Additionally, the liquid-cooled engine features a chain-driven single overhead cam for each cylinder bank, with two valves per cylinder. It uses a dry sump design like their 4-cylinder engines. As expected, the engine is fuel-injected and equipped with FADEC, also incorporating single-lever control. This means that both mixture and propeller pitch control is automatically adjusted as the pilot operates the throttle. The engine also features adaptive knock control and is capable of running on both F-gas and MoGas. The reduction ratio from engine to propeller is 3:1, meaning that at the engine's maximum RPM of 6,000, the propeller spins at only 2,000 RPM. While this is very slow, and that's actually a good thing, it does require the propeller blades to be longer to take full advantage of this slow turning speed. This could be an interesting consideration for retrofits, as the propeller blades would need to be longer than those used on the 2700 RPM direct drive engines it would replace. The engine is turbocharged, allowing it to maintain full power at much higher altitudes compared to normally aspirated engines, which lose roughly 3% of its total power for each 1000 feet it climbs. As a result, the V6 would have competed with the most powerful offerings from Lycoming, such as the IO 540 and even the IO 720. The latter produces way more power, producing 400 horsepower, but that's only at sea level. At 8,000 feet, the IO 720's power output would be around 300 horsepower due to lower density, and at higher altitudes, the Rotax engine would produce more power than the IO 720, making the V6 from Rotax a direct competitor. It would also compete against the IO 520, as well as the most powerful offering from the Continental stable at the moment, the TS IO 550. The fuel consumption of the V6 was reported as 16.5 gallons per hour or 63 liters per hour at 4,550 RPM, which is similar to its Lycoming and Continental competition. Of course, the Rotax can also run on MoGas, which is usually much cheaper than Avgas. So why didn't Rotax proceed with production of this engine? By all accounts, it was mechanically sound, as expected from Rotax. The development of this engine spanned about 10 years, which some interpreted as a sign of trouble with the design. I disagree with this opinion, especially considering that Rotax is an extremely cautious company, not known to rush into anything. When Rotax produces an engine for the aviation market, you can be confident that it's reliable, at least as reliable as its competitors. And achieving that reliability takes time. Some sources even claim that Rotax tested at least 15 of these engines to complete failure. Of course, this proves nothing, but I'm confident that there was no issues with this engine's design. Instead, something else happened during the final years of this engine's development, which I've already touched on. Bombardier, the parent company of Rotax, divested its recreational products division, which then became BRP Rotax. This new entity was no longer a part of Bombardier's aviation division. BRP's focus on recreational products didn't align with the intended use of Rotax's 300 horsepower engine, as it was designed for larger light aircraft, which included different uses. Even so, after spending millions on developing this new engine, it seems unlikely that Rotax would let it go to waste just because its use doesn't align with the company's new vision. No, there was another factor that stopped them from moving forward with production. As many know, a significant portion of the purchase cost of light aircraft and aircraft engines goes toward liability coverage. Manufacturers protect themselves against the inevitable lawsuits when product failures result in fatalities, whether they are at fault or not. To give you an idea of the scale of these liability costs, in the late 1980s it was estimated that the cost of liability was between $70,000 and $100,000 per airplane built. Per airplane! A large portion of that liability coverage would fall on the engine manufacturer. With the increasingly litigious culture, it's safe to assume that these costs would have risen significantly by the year 2000. This is one of the main reasons aircraft engines are so expensive, especially certified variants, despite their relatively simple designs. So why would Rotax see this as an issue with their new V6 design, but not on their existing aviation product line? This is probably why some conspiracy theorist types suggested that the engine was problematic. Others argued that since the new engine would be used in 4 and 6 seat aircraft, the potential for lawsuits would double or triple compared to their 4 cylinder engines, which usually powers 2 seat airplanes. And more people on board means more families that could sue in the event of fatal accidents. While that's true, the price of the engine would have included coverage for such liability, so I don't believe this alone was the deciding factor in BRP's decision. Especially considering that Rotax's latest entries, the 915 and 916, are used on 4-seat aircraft. So why doesn't this concern Rotax with their 4-cylinder engines, but it does for their new V6? In 1994, the General Aviation Revitalization Act, or GARA, was introduced. As the name implies, it was created to help revitalize the general aviation sector after the massive slump in the 1970s and 80s by limiting the duration of manufacturers' liability, which by this point was killing the industry. So in essence, GARA shields engine and airframe manufacturers from most liability claims on engine designs older than 18 years. This is why Rotax benefits from GARA on their 4-cylinder engines. But GARA wouldn't apply to their new design, and Rotax would need to endure 18 years of risk before it could. Being the cautious company they are, BRP decided that the liability risk of the new V6 engine was unacceptably high compared to expanding their existing 4-cylinder lineup, which does benefit from the protection offered by GARA. So is the 120-degree V6 engine gone for good? Possibly, but the advantages of this design didn't go unnoticed by other aero engine companies. Notably, Adept has taken the design and added their own spin to it. I've made a dedicated video about the Adept V6, which is linked in the video description. I've also heard rumors that other companies are or were trying their hand at designing 120-degree V6 aero engines, but only time will tell if we'll ever see one come to market. Thanks for watching. See you in the next one.